A very good morning, afternoon, or evening, wherever you are, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the next edition of the Virtual Happy Hour with the Drunken Grape. We're featuring extraordinary drinks with extraordinary people having incredibly successful, insightful, and impactful individuals on a weekly basis. Now, the feature today is an SEO and e-commerce genius. He's built an eight-digit empire in the past. He was integral with it. He has his hands into a variety of different things today, consulting, often assisting and aiding companies in growing their online platform, particularly with online sales. It's with great pleasure to introduce to one of my great friends also, the Polish Prince, the expert of e-commerce and SEO, the great Alex Czartoryski. Alex, how the hell are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Thanks for that great intro, Rob. It's great to be here. It's great to be on your podcast to share some good drinks.
Well, yeah, and you know, we're going to get into some of the stuff with that. We will definitely get into the happy hour momentarily, but you have a really interesting story because when I met you back in around 99, the year 2000, might have even been 2001, but it was in that stretch. You were working, you had graduated, I believe, with a computer math degree. You were working in a high-tech firm. I believe you worked for the great Arlene Dickinson at one point. But you stepped out and you got into a very unique business. It's you were part of the online licensing process for all the boaters across Canada, and eventually you moved that business into the United States. It was Boater Exam Online. Talk to me a bit about how you got introduced to that. I know the founder, Larry, the main founder, Larry, brought you in with his son, Brent, and then you became the technical arm. So talk a bit about how Larry discovered that and how this incredible, what eventually became an eight-digit empire by the time you sold it, came to be, because it's not every day that somebody gets to this level of business excellence.
Right, yeah. So I went to university with a good friend of mine, Brent, and Brent's father, Larry, who was an avid fisherman and boater, had recently retired from his government job and was looking for his next big thing. And being in boating, he got recruited to be a classroom course instructor for these boating safety courses because the federal government's bringing in a new law where every boater needs to get a boating license. And as he was doing these courses, he thought to himself, well, why can't we do this online? And it turned out you could do them online. There was a regulation where you could, just no one was doing it. And so long story short, Larry went out on his own, brought a team together and started to build boaterexam.com. And so part of that team was Larry, the founder. There was my good friend Brent, who was kind of the extroverted sales guy, and then it was me, the introverted tech nerd, and we also had two other of our friends, James Steele and eventually Kerry Moore. And it was great synergy. We had great synergy between our strengths and our weaknesses, really complementing each other, and it was a classic startup story. This was early 2000s. We were working nights and weekends, sweating it out in our basements, trying to build this e-learning e-commerce platform. This was before Shopify, so you can just pop something up and have e-commerce going. It was before Amazon Web Services, so you can just throw up this virtual site to be hosted. You have to build everything from scratch, so hardware, software, hosting, build the load balancing, security. And we had to build a platform that would eventually handle over 5,000 e-commerce transactions an hour. Which even to this
day,
I find I'm super proud of, and it's an amazing
no kidding
thing. And yeah, so we, from the early days, bootstrapped that for many years. Although my job was kind of the head of technology and software development, we had to wear a lot of hats. We were a small company. So I was also doing the product design and roadmap, web usability, conversion rate optimization, search engine optimization, pay-per-click, digital advertising, plus all the other kind of non-technical stuff and kind of the business operations, HR, legal, taxation, accounting, leadership, just a ton of stuff. And we learned a ton. We made a ton of mistakes, but overall we did more things right than wrong and built a pretty successful business in the end with a great team of over 50 people, revenues over $10 million a year, working for over 50 state and federal agencies in boating, hunting, ATV, snowmobile. We even built a drone course for Intel for their drone program. And
wow, that's cool.
It was actually an amazing success for us. We couldn't have done it without our great team and kind of my co-founders, but it was great. It was awesome.
Yeah, and you know, this is a cool journey because I remember you carrying Dell servers up a flight of stairs that would arrive at the apartment. You know, our great friend, one of our very best friends, Louis Mauvoisin, you lived with him, and I would always go over and hang out. And we'd watch you, you know, it'd be Saturday night sometimes. And this is no joke that you worked day and night because we remember, hey, Alex, you want to come out with us? And you're like, well, you know what? I can do that in about 2 hours and meet you at the bar, but I got to set up these two servers right now. And it goes to tell you, back in those days, it was hardware intensive. It's not like you can just shoot everything into the cloud today and it's completely secure. I mean, you had a physical footprint. You had to know about architecture, which I'm sure you learned a fair bit about on the fly. I know that you learned to eventually build servers, which was crazy. And on top of that, the branding and marketing effort that, you know, that you contributed to, but Larry and Brent came up with, was quite incredible because the name was catchy, Boater Exam Online. And correct me if I'm wrong, but you had some stiff competition in the beginning of this all too. I mean, there was other firms that were nipping at the bid, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, so there was, I think, over 100 providers that were approved to issue courses. I think online there was probably 10 of them. The early days, we had a head start. We were the only kind of young tech savvy people. We got into search optimization really early and kind of the digital marketing really early. So we had a good head start. And so the first few years were, we were mainly focused on building the platform, but the online competition, we were pretty dominant in that. But yeah, later on, particularly as we got into the US, we faced some really, really stiff competition that forced us to really raise our game and get going. Yeah.
Oh yeah. I mean, I can imagine it's the largest marketplace in the world. It's the biggest economy in the world. And it is definitely, you know, if you scale it, was it about 12 times the population of Canada, roughly?
Yeah, much bigger. And kind of with our success in Canada, we went into the US quite cocky and kind of got put in our place quickly. But then it kind of made us better and had to work harder. And overall, it was a good learning experience and a success.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, the spinoffs from this. So you sold this to a private equity company, what, about 5 or 6 years ago now?
Yeah, back in 2017, which was also that was my first experience with private equity, and was a super positive and super interesting experience to work with really smart people.
That's
cool. It
was a
private equity firm from Philadelphia called Inverness Graham. It was really great people.
Wow, that's awesome. And that's great that you had that experience. I mean, that's usually once in a lifetime for only a very small handful of business people, because you have to have something that really, I would think, scales beyond $10 million for an equity firm to be interested in you. And it's a feat, let alone to hit $1 million in business. Like, I mean, this is no joke. People just talk about a million like it's like an inch on the battlefield, but it's actually yards. It's basically to the goal line on the battlefield or the football field, if you want to use a sports analogy. And the fact that you got it to 8 digits, it's the only way you're going to bring that kind of interest level into purchasing you.
Yeah, I like to say, like, all successes are relative. So $1 million is amazing. It's a great success. And when we first hit that number, it was kind of high fives and popping success. And it's actually amazing.
Oh, yeah.
But you realize quickly that it's relatively huge, but it's also relatively tiny. And same with 10 million, relatively huge, relatively tiny. And it's just kind of it's all relative in scales. And there's always a bigger fish than you. But it's all kind of amazing accomplishments.
Well, it's kind of like the way the virtual event space is going. A lot of players are jumping into it now. I moved into it at the start of the pandemic. I was, kind of a lead off into it. Live events weren't coming back. I moved into that last fall, and it's done very well. And it's kind of like yourself. A lot of players get into the game, but very few actually do it really well or have the natural inclination and capability to do it or put the proper team around you. And that's just a testament of a great success story, because you had all the right working elements, even though you made, you know, mistakes along the way. And I see that I make mistakes along the way right now in my own present business growth. And, you know, all you do is you go back and correct them. You know, that's it. And you get good advice. I mean, you've given me brilliant advice on the back end of the website. You've really helped me out a lot with that. And for viewers watching this, you know, first of all, subscribe to this channel, like and share this content, but reach out to Alex. His details are going to be in the description of the show itself on YouTube, and this is going to be shared on social media. But definitely reach out to people like Alex because he's real, he's legitimate, he has an excellent track record, he's very smart. And Alex, you really have a very good understanding of how this all works. I mean, your recommendation, you know, talk to us a bit about how you build something from the ground up. If you're working with a client, from how you take them from local to regional to national or possibly even international with search engine optimization, because it's an art on its own.
Yeah, so I like to classify myself as like an e-commerce generalist and a digital marketing specialist. So my strength is kind of my broad knowledge of everything e-commerce and how businesses work, but my really focus lately has been on digital marketing, kind of really, although there's the organic search part, but the quick gains are often gained from the paid side of things. And so I use kind of Google and Facebook ads and really focused on profitable growth. So building a foundation where it's not just putting money in at every dollar that you spend needs to generate a dollar out. And hopefully that revenue that you generate from that initial dollar can then get refunded and create a flywheel effect that allows you to grow your business and have success without necessarily putting a lot of risk on the line.
Yeah, that's cool. And, you know, for people watching this that call themselves influencers, and some of them are influencers, they got huge social media followings, it's still integral to tie that all into a well-developed website. You know, you Shopify, which is what you used, you recommended I use when I put my website, the new website together, thedrunkengrape.com. It was great. You really helped optimize it. And this is where a lot of people are stuck today because some of the younger generation feels they don't need a website. And I've seen some of this folly even being propagated by baby boomers and some Gen X professionals that have had success on social media. But what they're missing here is the whole tie-in. It's like, it's almost as important. It's as important as your email campaign. I mean, emailing is important too because everybody checks their inbox, but everybody wants to go see a site. And it's very, very important to have this optimized. Ladies and gentlemen watching this, I cannot stress this point any further. You want a man like Alex or a lady with Alex's skills. You want somebody with the skill that Alex has to really implement this for you. And this is just no joke. I mean, I think of Canvas Pop and now Creative Layer, Nazim Ahmed, our mutual friend who's done great things in the world of business, his old partner Adrian Salunovic, you know, and a number of individuals have highly recommended you here as well, locally, Alex, and they've branched your name out nationally as well. So this gives credit to what you've done. And with that, it's the happy, happy hour. We got some sour beers here. Cheers, Alex.
Cheers.
You know, cheers to the audience. So as you're cracking that, I'll quickly ramble on this one. This is a sherry sorbet sour. So sour beers have an interesting background. They go all the way back to a very ancient style of farmhouse brewing, spontaneous fermentation. So what happens here is they also often mimic the godfather of it all, lambic brewing. Belgian lambic brewing around Pyotenland by the Seine River. It's a designated region. It's classified like a Grand Cru in the wine world. And what they do is they use aged hops typically because you don't want a high hop inflection. In fact, you don't want a hop inflection in most cases at all with a sour. It's spontaneous fermentation means it's open to my viewers here. So as a beer sommelier, I learned a lot about this, did a lot of blind tastings on this. And this style, what has happened is lambics can't be called lambics outside of it, but they're called sours in Germany. They're goza, like they're soda pop-like beverages. They've got a sparkling like champagne, great effervescence. And what they do is they ferment in open containers. In the Belgian side, it's cool ships. It's literally shaped like a wooden vessel. It's about that deep. And in it, it's this long, wide, and shallow fermentation, open fermentation vessel. What happens is they start off with Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which is the standard ale yeast used in fermentation. So they pitch that in. But this is the wort. After they have malted and mashed the grains, or the grist, it comes out as this syrupy, sugary concoction ready for fermentation. What they do is they leave it out in the open air, so it gets attacked by a pile of microbes. So you also get a wild yeast strain called Brettanomyces, which some old world vineyards use. I know this is common in Burgundy with Pinot Noir production in particular, some Chardonnay production. And it's hard to regulate, so you really have to know what you're doing. Often these sours are blends because of it. So Brettanomyces takes months to attack it. And in the meantime, it gets inoculated with bacteria. And it's Pediococcus and Lactobacillus. And that's why there's a lactic character. And it makes these funky styles. Now, this is a cherry style. It's based on basically a lambic creek, which would be a cherry lambic. And they tend to keep their color, but it does tend to fade. Notice how it has a pale, it almost has a pale pink look to it. It's hazy because there's pale malts in the grain bill, but there's a lot of wheat in the grain bill. These things are typically about 37 to 40% wheat. It's based on a Belgian style. Now, they tend to be really tart, almost wine-like in characteristic. Lots of acidity. They're funky. You know, I featured this on Daytime Ottawa recently on the Thanksgiving show for the Canadian Thanksgiving. I also had a virtual tasting with a great company called Nutanix yesterday, which employs like 6,000 people around the world. They do a lot of cloud computing and virtualization, and we shared this. And just think of having this with ice cream or sorbet. Think of vanilla, strawberry, cherry, chocolate, Nutella. Think of things like even a goat cheese and green salad with a raspberry or cherry vinaigrette, because it's going to complement it. You know, remember, everything works on the three C's, cut, complement, or contrast. And the acidity of this is going to chop through the cheese itself. For the happy hour, Alex, you got a sour there too. So how's that one on that end? Talk to us a bit about it. Who's the brewer?
So brewer, I've never had this before, but it's...
if you hold that one up to the camera a little bit, let's take a look at it. So here's the brewer.
It's Small Pony Brewing, Barrel Works out of Kanata, Ottawa here. And here's the beer. So I was kind of...
the apocalypse.
Scared. Yeah, the tropical apocalypse, a blend of golden sour beers aged in oak barrels with pineapples. It's a beautiful day here in Ottawa, so... Yeah, so your description was bang on, like very sour, funky. I could taste a bit of the pineapple and those foods you recommended. Yeah, I could see this going perfectly with it. I don't drink sour beers a lot, but this is super interesting.
Nice. Sounds great. Yeah, and use fruit juice in the process as well. That's common. So that's where you get creeks. That's where you get framboise, you know, the... strawberry wheat beers, like the legendary Fruly. But that sounds awesome. I'm definitely going to have to reach out to that brewery. And this is the thing, ladies and gentlemen. Check out your craft brewers. Go to your local wineries. Go to your local distilleries. And, you know, on that note of a nice drink and the happy hour, Alex, we're going to share some details about your personal life first, being related to Polish nobility. Now, we got some pictures to share. And before I get into this, we're going to set up the screen share. But this was hilarious. So I remember looking at, I'm going to have to go to a different site here for a minute, bear with me, but we had a Polish band on one of the cruise ships I worked on, and it was the Old Orient Crown Odyssey. We're going around the world, and this is hilarious because with this, we had a Polish band, and I'm talking with them in the crew bar. And this is like at 1 o'clock in the morning, you know, we're sharing some drinks and stories, and I'm sitting back going, you know, my good friend was a Polish prince, a great buddy. He's in the tech business. He's starting to do really well. I was telling him your personal story. And I said, I call him Czartoryski. And they go, is this a Czartoryski? And I go, yeah. He goes, you know nobility from Poland. And they were all excited. And Livio, the bandmaster, just talked with me about this joy for a few hours. He was so excited about this. So we're going to bring this up. I'm going to share this. So this, I take it, was this one was the film of Triple X. So they superimposed. It almost looks like the Matterhorn, but not quite in the background. But those are look like Swiss Alps. So talk to us a bit about this castle, Alex, and that story. This is really cool.
Yeah, and to clarify, so this castle was used in the movie Triple X with Vin Diesel. So it's not a pornographic film. It's a Vin Diesel Hollywood film. So here's this castle. So this castle actually belonged to my great grandfather. So my Polish family history comes from a noble aristocratic Polish family with a long history, and all my ancestors were historically large landowners with some power and influence in Poland. And it was actually my great grandfather's hunting lodge, if you'd believe it. I think it was sitting on something like 20,000 hectares of forest and had over 100 rooms in there. So quite
wow. The, we're going to bring up the next one. So here's the other slide. So look at this place. This almost reminds me in some ways of the castle that you would see in Sintra. You know, there's that castle, that palace in Sintra, Portugal. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but this is beautiful. Alex, could we throw a wine party in there sometime? You know, could we fly your friends over and throw a bash?
So unfortunately, it doesn't belong to the family anymore. It's a museum in the Czech Republic. Most of kind of the wealth of the family between kind of the Russian-Polish uprising and the First and Second World Wars was either destroyed or confiscated or taken away in some way. So a lot of this stuff is kind of historical in nature, but still very cool to have that in the family. It makes for great stories. And you'll notice in this castle that there's that little building on the right, the yellow one, is a church that was kind of built as part of that.
Wow. So talking of palace treasures, yes, go ahead, Alex. This artwork.
So
who is this?
So this is a painting by Leonardo da Vinci called Lady with Ermine, quite famous. And it's kind of the prized piece of the Czartoryski Museum in Krakow in Poland. And I think that, wow. So that museum was founded by my great, 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 great grandmother, if I got that right. And I think they would say it was, its market value is somewhere around 2 billion euros.
Wow.
Let's go buy a small island. The entire collection. Yeah, so there's Rembrandts in there, Donatello's, all kinds of great pieces of art. And worth seeing if you're in Krakow. Belongs to the state now. It's a government museum. So not my
cool
private connection.
That's cool. And cheers to that. You know, sociable, skull. Well, I can't remember what the Russians or the Polish say in it. There's a cheers. Nazdrovia. Yes, I had a friend on Greg Campbell, the great Cran Gamble, and his wife's Bulgarian, and they say Nazdrovia.
Yes, very similar kind of
cheers
language.
So that is really cool. I mean, this is not every day that you come across stuff like this. And, you know, this is just awesome. So we have a little bit of other things to go through here. I'm going to bring up the tab. We have, I believe, where is it? I'm going to close this out. But we have some other stuff to talk about because, you know, we've got the Manitoba Mucklucks in here. And I'm going to bring that up very shortly. So I've got the site here. So I think we can go in and share it. And what we're going to do is just take a look at it, actually. Kind of learning how to use this a bit still, so bear with me. I was bouncing around like a yo-yo. But before we do that, let's talk about Gongshou Hockey. This is really cool because you, I believe, have you have a hand into this company itself. I believe that you have some involvement.
Yeah, so how I got involved with Gongshou, so my co-founder in Boater Exam, Brent, his brother Jerry was a co-founder of Gongshou Hockey with a few of his hockey buddies back in 2002. And so as we were building Boater Exam, there's always kind of that family connection parallel with Gongshou and what they were doing. So we always had a lot of collaborations and brainstormings, thinking of what we do differently in our businesses. And as Borderland was growing and we had more resources available, it made sense to incubate Gongshou within our infrastructure to help them grow. So we shared office space, our internet, telephony, accounting, and legal resources while they were smaller, and that helped them grow. And then as they got bigger, and as kind of Borderland hit its peak and kind of went down to more of a sustainable thing, they were able to take over some of our resources. And yeah, it was fun because I'm not a boater or a hunter, and so having this kind of like side project in Gongshou, it was a lot of fun, which was into hockey and fashion and even into beer at one point. They had this beauty beer brand that was brewed via Big Rig breweries here in Ottawa.
That's awesome.
And it was a ton of fun, and was fun and rewarding to have been involved in their growth and success and to have a small part to plan their growth. And so it was a lot of fun to be
part of that. It's like sport hockey gear, which is really cool. I'm sorry that came up there, that weekly promotion, but you've got, I'm going to stop sharing this for a second. I'll bring it back up, but you have, something really cool here. So what is cool here about Gongshou? Let's get rid of that. Let's come back to the set here. This is cool because it's hockey gear. They got shirts, they have jeans, they have hats, they have hoodies. But we all know that obviously they're going to have a big market for men. But what's cool here is that you actually have some really cool looking outfits for women that want to get involved in wearing this gear too.
Yeah, so very kind of also focus giving kind of equal play to women's hockey as to men's hockey. I think that's really important. And yeah, so we make a lot of product that has cool hockey sayings and kind of the stuff that hockey players wear when they're not playing hockey at the bar. Or
yeah, and they got it.
Or hang out with their friends.
Just to interject here too, you have, I believe you are part of this to some degree, but there's NHL, they have a tie into the whole NHL Hockey League too, don't they? Like the National Hockey League, which is huge.
So that I'm not sure of exact details of that. I think at one point we had a relationship with the NHLPA, but I wouldn't be the right person to speak on that. I wouldn't want to say.
No, but it's cool that you still had some involvement. You still had some involvement in that, which is cool, you know. And I think that's neat. So we're gonna get into something you're directly working with right now. So I'm just gonna get this set up. I'm trying to close it out, but again, we're looking at some neat things here. This is Manitoba Mucklucks. So I'm just trying to load up the products here. So we're just looking quickly at this site too, because from what I understand, you're working with your friend Josh Fine on this, and you guys, what's great about this business is, and I love these stories because it's profitable, but it gives so much back to humanity. In this case, you give back a ton to the native community. Like, there's a really good give back story that goes with that. Share that with the viewers because I think they would love to hear this just as we get close to wrapping things up here.
So Mucklucks, which I have one here, is
nice.
The traditional indigenous winter boot that's been worn by indigenous peoples in Canada for thousands of years. And they're super functional, super comfortable, kind of works of art too. And you'll see that unlike a regular boot, these are like super flexible. So it's kind of like wearing a flip-flop almost. And
oh,
there's
wow.
A lot of room. And so they're super warm for on your shoes, unlike a traditional boot that's very hard and cold. So this company was founded by Sean McCormick, a Métis entrepreneur from Winnipeg, that manufactured these boots for a long time, but there's no brand tied to it. So eventually he partnered with my friend Josh to try and build a global brand around it to have a bigger impact in the indigenous community. And so that's how the brand Manitoba Mucklucks was born. And it's very deeply rooted in the indigenous community, and they make a big focus on making a big social impact and give back to help the indigenous community, not just from a monetary sense, but also to inspire them that say, hey, you could build something bigger, you could be an entrepreneur, you could be a leader in your community. and just an amazing product, a great story, and just a great brand. And they're Canada's fastest growing footwear brand right now. And that's also been super rewarding to have played a small part in their success.
That's awesome. You know, and we're looking at some mittens here. I'm just going to go over this shortly. Obviously, you got some really high level or high quality mittens and gloves here too. One thing I've always seen, I've been to a few native arts and crafts shows. They come along a lot every winter towards the holiday season and the Christmas season. And they make some of the best quality things. You're going to pay for it, but that's what quality is. And the beauty of this is you're supporting their economy. You're supporting their communities. And, you know, we won't get into it too much, but with here in Canada, the residential school system and lacking proper drinking water on the reserves, which is insane. We need to do everything to help them because they are Indigenous. You know, they are the forefathers of this country and foremothers of this country. And I think it's great that you're a part of this. I think it's great that you are helping build this up. You know, Alex, we're just going to get to a close here. We've covered off a lot today. We've covered off a really impressive journey, your business journey, your scholastic journey preceding the business journey. You know, you've had a business career that's been very exciting for 2 decades now. You'd make the Polish nobility very proud by rocketing on your own without any support from being a prince. But listen, what's the best way for people to get a hold of you on a parting note?
I think LinkedIn is probably the best way. I do have my own personal blog that I occasionally update, but LinkedIn is probably the best way to reach me.
Awesome. Listen, cheers to that. One more toast. You have been a tremendous guest. This is Alex Czartoryski, e-commerce and SEO genius, ladies and gentlemen. Make sure to reach out to him. He will help maximize your business, whether you are a small mom and pop shop or a multi-billion dollar global enterprise. This is a man you want to reach out to. Listen, you've been a tremendous guest. Ladies and gentlemen, have a terrific day, whatever you decide to do. This is Rob from the Drunken Brewer.
Thanks, Rob.